Hallelujah, hallelujah. Shabbat shalom, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. We are going to have a wonderful time in the Lord. Amen. Amen. Once one last time, let's worship Him. Let's give Him our best because He deserves it. If everyone will stand up, raise your hands and worship because He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. And He deserves it regardless of how I feel. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for this day. You are awesome, God. And we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. Is that your heart's desire? Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
who loves me.
Lord,
altar never burn out. Fire on my altar never burn out. May the fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer. May the fire on my altar never burn out. Fire on my altar never burn out. May the fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer. Day and night and night and day. Day and night and night and day. Day and night and night and day. Make me a house of prayer. Day and night and night and day. Day and night and night and day. Day and night and night and day. Make me a house of prayer. Lord, make me a house. Make me a house of prayer. Never burn out. May the fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer. May the fire on my altar never burn out. Fire on my altar never burn out. May the fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer. May the fire on my altar never burn out. Fire on my altar never burn out. May the fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer. May the fire on my altar never burn out. Fire on my altar never burn out. May the fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer. Lord, make me a house. Make me a house of prayer.
About this before when we've done this song, but the fire can only keep going when the sacrifice is continual, not a partial sacrifice every now and then. It can only continue when the sacrifice is on the altar continually, all the time. Hallelujah. May the fire on our altar be never put out. Hallelujah.
May the fire on my altar never burn out. May the fire on my altar never burn out. May the fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer. May the fire on my altar never burn out. May the fire on my altar never burn out. May the fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer. May the fire on my altar never burn out. May the fire on my altar never burn out. The fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house of prayer. Lord, make me a house. Make me a house of prayer.
Come on, let's reach up to Him. He is great. He's in this place. If you haven't received something yet, you're missing out. You know, the whole world's getting ready to celebrate Labor Day. You know, usually what happens in the natural is a reflection of what's happening in the spiritual realm. You may not think these things have any meaning, but let me tell you, they have all the meaning. You know, they're about to celebrate Labor Day having to do with the works. But I believe 100% God's going to use this day for a different type of labor. You know, a lot of us pray for God to do something in our life, and what happens is it often brings more pain. Let me say it like this. It makes you feel broken. You say, God, well, I prayed for this, but what I got instead was what I feel like is pain to me. But God does that for purpose. You know, a lot of times we ask God for something, but we don't know what the cost is to get us there. I believe 100%. That we are going through the birthing pains. If you don't know scripture, the birthing pains is what happens when God is trying to birth something out of you, but it costs you. Like the Bible says, when a woman is in travail with the pains of birth, she forgets her pain when what is birthed into is a promise. Y'all been praying for something, and you feel broken because of it. You feel like there's pain, but God is bringing you to that point. The birthing pains are going to pass, and then your reward comes in, and you forget all the pain you went through. But we're in that point. We're in the birthing pains. You wonder why you're in that place where you feel broken. It's not because God's left you. It's not because God's forsaken you or you have done something wrong. You're in the birthing pains. God's getting ready to birth something in you. Y'all have been praying for a lot of things. How many of us every day pray for something, whether it's a gifting, spiritual insight? Do you know the cost to get there? Some of us pray for things that the reward, the cost us so much. We don't realize when someone says, hey, I want to be used in this office. You don't know the cost to get there. We're in the birthing pains. We're lining up with the book of Revelation. Did you know that? Birthing pains are important. That's why the whole earth is grumbling right now, waiting for the manifestations of the sons and daughters of God. That's why there's an increase in earthquakes. A shaking is taking place because God is getting ready to birth into the earth something new. And that's why it's important when you're going through those birthing pains not to give up, not to be dismayed, not to be disappointed. It's because God is about to birth something in you that will manifest out into the earth. You're about to be made manifest in the earth. God is about to birth something out of you. Every person in this place, God is about to birth something out of you. Everybody on live stream, God is about to birth something out of you. All for the glory of His kingdom. Not for your glory, but the glory of His kingdom. So we ought to give God praise. He doesn't forsake us at all. He loves us so much. Man, I love what I feel today. It's about to burst something out in us. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you all so much for joining us. We're about to go to God in prayer. He is a God that answers prayers. Amen. Come on. Let me tell you, He answered my prayer when I woke up this morning. Lord, give me another day to live better than I did yesterday. He answered my prayer. Let me tell you, if He breathed into you this morning, understand, you don't have life until He says, breathe. The breath you breathe is literally the breath of God. Everyone says it comes from the ocean and trees. No, it comes from God. You can't do anything without God. If you're a sinner in the world right now, His mercy is even stretched to you right now. His grace is stretched to you. But He's a God that answers. It may not be in your timing, but His timing is perfect. I am just so happy to be here, what I feel and the things of God. So let's raise our hands. If you have a need, God already knows the need. Even before you are ever created, He knew everything. He knew what you were going to need. He knew what your name was before your parents even knew who you are. When you were in the womb, He knew who you are. He knew who you would be in the fullness and completeness of Him. So there is nothing He can't do. He knows every hair on your head. He knows my count zero. But He's a God that knows the number. Amen. And I love Him. So let's go before God. If you need something, let me tell you, if you're in the birthing pains, give Him some worship. Give Him some glory. Understand God is going to do something in you. Don't be disappointed. Don't let the devil win. Don't let the devil sneak in and take what God's about to birth in you. That's the problem with most Christianity. They get disappointed because they're going through something and God's trying to get them to point A to point B, but they think God's forgot them. No, you imagine what would have happened if Meshach, Radshach, and Abednego would have went in the fire and said, well, God's forgot about us. They would have been consumed. But before they were even thrown in the fire, you know what they told him? No matter what happens, and I'm paraphrasing, basically he said, no matter what happens, whether you throw us in this fire or not, we're going to worship the God above. No fire in front of us is going to deter us from wanting to worship God. And they were thrown in, and what happened? They were not consumed. In fact, not one piece of clothing was burnt. No little frays of fabric because of the heat. No facial hair burned at all. No hair, nothing. Perfectly safe in the fire because their faith was in God. I'm ready to be birthed out. Hallelujah, Jesus. So let's go before the Lord. Father, we thank you, Jesus, for all that you do for us, Lord. You are worthy, Jesus, of all my praise. You are worthy to be exalted, Lord, high above all things. And Lord, we come before you, Lord Jesus, and all those who are facing, Lord, the labor pains, Father. Prepare us, Lord, for what is about to be birthed out, Lord, in us. I thank you, Jesus, Lord. Raise us up, Father, in these last days. Lord, the world is getting darker. But Father, I pray more than ever that we would be closer and closer to you. Father, to a place, Lord, when the world starts shaking even more, Father, worse things are coming yet on this earth. I pray that we won't be shaken, Father, but we will stand bold, Lord, before all, proclaiming the gospel, Father, proclaiming your love, Lord, proclaiming the truth of the kingdom of God, not wavering, Lord Jesus, but standing strong, bold as lions, Father, roaring in the face of the enemy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Darker times are coming, Lord. But Lord, let our lights not be dimmer. But Lord, as the world gets darker, let our lights get brighter. So people will run to us, Father, and say, you know Jesus. Tell us about him. Hallelujah, Jesus. You are worthy, Father. Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen and amen. Let's give the Lord a mighty hand clap of praise. He is worthy of it all. Hallelujah. 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 All those on live stream, all those here in the sanctuary, thank you for joining us today. We welcome you. We love you all. We want to grow more and more because you know what? God is here. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to share with you something real quick. I'm going to move out of the way so the real preaching can be done. Amen. Hallelujah. But you know what? We had another great time out on the outreach. You know, if you haven't been there, please join us.
Yes.
It is really fun, and you don't understand how happy it makes people to see us out there.
Yes.
We have people from other churches waving, giving us thumbs up, honking, and going nuts out their window. You know, and it's a great time. We had a person, me and Sister Bobby were out there, and we were standing there, and we had somebody walk past us and stop and say, are you guys hungry or thirsty? They were willing because of what we were doing, the things of the kingdom. You know, when Jesus sent the apostles out, he said, take nothing for you. This is all going to be provided. Don't put anything in your satchels. Don't do anything like that. But the word itself will provide.
Yes.
He sent us somebody who was willing to check on us. And that's what we want to see. That's the word. That's the very kingdom nature. Amen.
Yes.
So please join us. We get to wave at a lot of people. They honk. You know, we don't necessarily get to talk to everyone all the time. But you know what? We're changing people.
Right.
People honk. And you don't know how much one thing can change somebody whose mindset is at the breaking point, and they see one scripture that just changes.
Yes.
Amen. We had a group of motorcyclists. I think it was last week to Ben Hammond was out there. And a group of motorcyclists went by him and started giving him the thumbs up. Dressed in leather, tattoos, and everything else. You wouldn't think they were kingdom-minded.
Right.
But that's the church, the judgment that a lot of people see. They see people that don't necessarily fit in. We want them here. I don't care what you look like. I don't care what you ride, what you drive. Get here. Because those things don't matter. Your soul does. So please come out. We're there every Saturday at 9:15. You don't have to stay for the full hour.
Right.
You don't have to at all. Get out there. You don't have to hold a sign. You don't have to talk if you don't want to. Just wave.
Yeah.
Wave. Let people see why you want them to be a part of the kingdom.
Yeah.
If you're not smiling all the time, happy and excited about the things of the kingdom, I'm worried about you. Because when I think about the things of the kingdom, I can't help but to smile. Sometimes I weep. Because that's our reward. The things of the kingdom were not of this earth. We are just passing by. Amen. Amen. So let's welcome Sister King as she comes up. And let's have a great service. And we look forward to the cookout. Amen.
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 Cookout with a word first, right? Shabbat shalom, everybody. Eat spiritually, and then our physical bodies get food, right? Amen. So to go along just for a second with what Brother Tucker said, it is the word to meet somebody else's need. And who does he use? All of us, right? How many times have you needed something, you've prayed for something, and somebody did not know that need, or maybe they did, and they met that need for you? Amen. That is how God works. And also, I mean, he has angels in the earth as well. It says that we entertain angels unaware, but he also uses us. So don't neglect, if something's being impressed upon you, to give somebody food or drink or money, whatever it is, at that time, listen to that and play, you know, seek into that to see if there's more to it and be that blessing that you like people to be to you as well. It says in Matthew 25 and 36, I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. Basically, they met their need, right? Even if it's just being a friend. Sometimes people just need a hug. They just need to be listened to. They don't need to be, you know, downed upon for any decisions that they've made or what have you. And that's what we're supposed to be, our friends, correct? Amen. So if we can go ahead and bring the ushers down here for tithe and offering, we'll go ahead and get that started. And I wanted to mention as well that most of us are aware of this, but sometimes we overlook, many of us give our tithes, some of us give our offerings, not everybody. That's between you and God. I'm not asking for that. I wanted to read Proverbs 3 and 9. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase. This does not just mean what you work for. If somebody hands me $1 million, I'm going to tithe and give offering on it, whether I worked for it or not. Right? Amen. Because it says, of all your increase, the first fruits of all your increase, not the last part of it. Well, this is what I have left. So I just felt like sometimes, you know, even I overlook that. You know, we still give, obviously, we still give our tithes and offerings and all of that. But I just wanted to make mention before everybody gives today. Of course, we take cash. She's got Proverbs 3:9 up there for me. Thank you, Crystal. Take cash or check. If you write a check out, please make it to the ARC or the Revival Center or digitally, Cash App, Money Sign, ARC Peru, www.paypal.com/paypalme/ARC Peru. You can give any of those ways. That and the Cash App and the digital wave of PayPal are on our website at www.revivalcenterperu.com. We do get that immediately. It comes through on our phones, and it's very secure. That's how we give as well. So we don't give here. We give to our spiritual leadership, okay? So let's go ahead and pray for the offering, tithe and offering. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to give to you. We thank you for the freedom that we have to worship you in spirit and in truth, God. And we just ask that you would bless this tithe and offering. Let it be shaken and running over more abundantly than we could ever think or imagine. In the name of Jesus, we ask and pray. Amen. Hallelujah. It's a beautiful day outside, y'all. How many of y'all been enjoying this weather? Can tell that it's kind of changing. Yes, amen. That's right, Kim. Y'all, I failed to mention last week about our upcoming feast days. This is in like a couple weeks. Don't throw tomatoes at me today. Wait till next week. You left your tomatoes at home. Well, good. We're in good hands then. So I'll go over the feast days in just a minute, but I did post them out on the bulletin board. So if you want to take a picture or they're on our Facebook page, I posted them there as well. I'll go over the upcoming events and then go the feast days because those kind of intertwine with this. So obviously today, after service, we are having hot dogs and hamburgers, beef hot dogs and hamburgers. We are asking that whenever you go through the line, just choose one meat, either a hamburger or a hot dog first, just to make sure we have enough to go around. We should, but it just makes it for the people in the back of the line, which are usually, you know, the leadership, because all of you scurry out of here while he's ministering. Shame on you. I'm just kidding. I'm just joking. But it is so the people and the entire line can get something that everybody else has gotten, okay? That's just courtesy. We will have people serving you. So just make that a mental note in your mind. If there's plenty left over, obviously y'all are more than welcome to go back for seconds. Already told our teenagers, so they're aware. So anywho, that'll be right after service. We are not starting anything until the moment the altar call is over. So whether you're standing back there or not, if you're standing back there and I find you and the service is not over, I'm going to ask you to come back in here anyway. That's just courtesy, y'all. We're not here for the food. We're here for the spiritual food. The other stuff is just extra, right? Amen. Amen. So thank you all for everybody that has contributed to that. And of course, if you are a visitor, you are more than welcome to stay. Anybody is more than welcome to stay. You know, if God can do it with the loaves and fishes, he can do it with this, right? With potato salad, Lord, please. No. y'all can laugh. It's okay. It's all right. how many of y'all remember what next week is? None of you. All right, cool. We're doing our job. It's the men's camping and fishing trip, right? So that's September. It is now September, guys, ladies and gentlemen. September. So September 8th, which is Friday through Sunday, the 10th, is the men's fishing and camping trip. By the way, the Corns are not here. They're out of town for their anniversary. I think it is their 43rd anniversary. So praise the Lord. Yes. Amen. They're not just skipping out. if you have not spoken to Brother Corn about that or paid your dues, because it is $10 per person, regardless of whether you're staying one night or two. So please get with him and get that paid if you have not done so. I've gone over this before, only two vehicles per site when you're staying overnight. During the day, it's a little bit different, and there is a $7 gate fee for per vehicle that goes through that area. Now, with that being said, we are having church next Saturday at the Pavilion at Missinawa, okay? So if you don't know how to get there, please get in touch with me. I would say get in touch with Pastor King, but I don't know how good his service is going to be out there because he's going. Okay? If you don't know how to get there, we'll just meet here at 10:30 and make sure that we can all, you know, carpool or over there or whatever. Men, if you are at the campground and your wife does not drive, please make sure that you get them a ride, whether it's with somebody else or with you, because most of you have children as well. So I just want to put that out there. We will still start at 11 a.m. at Missinawa Pavilion, and hopefully the weather's awesome, because if it, you know, this week's been any indication, it'll be nice. Sometimes it's good to have something different than just in the four walls, right? Amen. There is no gate fee to get to the pavilion. It is free. There is a little bit of a walk, so if you struggle walking, please plan to have a wheelchair of some sort or some way to get up there. It's not like a mile, okay? It's just several yards. And I think Brother Dan's stuff has been taken care of for that. So just FYI, where are we having service next Saturday? Yes. All right. People are listening. Service Friday, Pastor King. Are we doing service Friday? Okay. To be determined on service for service. Yeah, pay attention to social media, he says, because if the men are going out there, they run the camera. So, I mean, we can all, you know, have a fun time here. You know, us ladies can out-worship you men any day. Just saying. Woo! All right. Yeah, it depends on his job as well, he says, because he does work. So just pay attention to social media. We'll try to get a text out as well. If you are not on our texting tree, you must let me know so I can add your phone number. I try not to overdo it with that, but for something like this, that's kind of important. So Friday service is to be determined. Saturday, this upcoming Saturday, will be at Missinawa at the Pavilion. Okay? And I'm going to try to have some signage on the door in case somebody forgets or comes here instead. All hearts free and clear on that. Any questions? So good to see Sister Gwen back. I feel like it's been 3 months. Amen. She's been out of town with her family and her work schedule, so amen. We're glad to have her back. As always, we have our Monday night prayer meetings from 6:30 to 8. You don't have to stay the whole time. You can come for a few minutes, or you can be here the whole time, however you'd like to do it. We still have our Wednesday night Bible studies from 6:30 to 8:15. Food is provided for that, and Brother Dan typically leads that one. I wanted to mention September 11th, so not this upcoming Monday because that's Labor Day, but the following Monday, Amy is still planning to have her Bible study at Mack Park from 11 to 1. Unless something changes, that's the last thing I've gotten, the last information. And as Brother Tucker mentioned, on Saturday mornings, if he or his family are not out there for outreach, be our guest to go out there and just hold signs, or like you said, wave. That's important. You don't have to wait for a leader to be out there. Each one of us are leaders to a certain degree, right? Amen. Most of you know this, but the Sam's class is canceled for this weekend because Brother Tucker will be busy doing something else with the festivities going on. There are going to be games, guys. I forgot to mention that. Games today. I've mentioned it before. After or when the eating and stuff is going on. Okay? So it'll be fun. It'll be lots of fun. I don't know if there's any water games included in that or not. But so the men's fishing and camping trip takes the place of the men's meeting this month. That means our ladies' meeting is in 2 weeks from tomorrow, September 17th, and it is a pitch-in and fall craft. The fall craft is free. We just ask that you bring some food to pitch in for breakfast. Still start at 10 o'clock, right? Okay, still starting at 10. I also wanted to mention that the youth is starting a Bible study the second Saturday of every month. I've mentioned this before. Food will vary each time. September 16th will be their first youth Bible study at 5 p.m. here at the church. That's on a Saturday, 2 weeks from today. All right? And the next youth service is September 30th at 6 p.m. at the church. There's no food at that one. Please eat before you come, kids. And we are still having our harvest party October 14th at 6 p.m. Woo! Yeah, it's always a fun time. It's going to be a hayride and games and, yes, potentially a chili cook-off. I'll have more details from Sister Renee in the near future. but it's going to be fun. We had a great time last year as well. And we're also, I forgot to mention, the girls' tea. I have that sign-up out there as well. If you have young girls or grand girls or granddaughters or what have you, Amy and Carol are putting on a girls' tea at Mack Park on September the 24th, which is a Sunday, from 1 to 4:30. Girls can dress up and bring their favorite doll or stuffed animal. There is no cost. We're just asking that whatever's out there, it's to fruit and veggies. You just sign up for something and bring that, please. A short mini lesson with games and possibly a few prizes. And at this point, they're thinking about a nail polish station, a bracelet making station, paint a picture frame station, and decorate a cookie station. Lots of fun for the girls, right? Amen. Real girly stuff. So that brings me to, sorry guys, we have a lot going on. it's good, but it'll wear you out. Right? Your mind won't be doing the idle things that it says, you know, in the Bible that get us in trouble when we're idle. So, feast days. How many of y'all are excited? This is an exciting time. Yes. Amen. So, most of you know, but we do not celebrate Halloween. We do not celebrate Christmas. Because if you look back at the roots of those things, they are pagan as all get out. Okay? I didn't know it till I was an adult. Don't shoot me. It's on Google. Okay? Didn't come up with it. Can look it up. So, whatever you choose to do, we're not condemning you. I'm just telling you what we do, all right? And what we direct our church in doing. So, Feast of Trumpets. This is the one we never know the date for sure. It's usually one of 2 days. There's a reason for that. If you look in the Bible and the way it goes, when Jesus comes back, it will probably be on the Feast of Trumpets because we don't know, but we do know the season and we watch for things to happen. Right? So we are going to celebrate the Feast of Trumpets on September 16th, Saturday, during our normal 11 a.m. service. I think that's the day that the youth is having their Bible study. They might be called away doing their Bible study, right? So September 16th is our normal 11 a.m. service. That's not extra. It's just normal time. Feast of Atonement is 10 days after. According to, I believe it's Leviticus 23, you can read through all of those and it shows all of the information for each one. And it says for them to have a holy convocation on certain ones, which is where we come together and have a service, okay? This is why we have a Sabbath service and not a Sunday service. A Sabbath is Saturday. When we say Shabbat Shalom, that is peaceful Sabbath. And the Sabbath starts Friday night, which is why we have a Friday night service. The Hebrew calendar, it starts in the evening. We're backwards here. We start daytime and go the opposite. Just like man to change it, right? From what it was supposed to be. So Anyway, Feast of Trumpets, September 16th, Saturday, during our normal 11 a.m. service. Feast of Atonement, celebrate. This is the one that we had to do an extra one because it falls in the middle of the week or during the week. So we're doing that September 25th, which is a Monday, with service at 6:30 p.m. Normally, that's our prayer meeting night. We are not going to have prayer meeting that night. We will have a service. And this is one where it says a holy convocation. So if you have any way at all of getting here, it is your duty and responsibility to be here for the Lord, not for me, for God. Okay? Feast of Tabernacles, Sukkot. We will have our Tabernacles Sukkot up here within the next week and a half-ish, hopefully. And so y'all be able to see that again. But we are celebrating that on September 29th, Friday, at our normal service time at 7:30 p.m. And guys, this is the one with Deuteronomy 16, 16 through 17. Three times a year, all your males shall appear before the Lord your God in the place which he chooses, at the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of Weeks, those are already passed, and at the Feast of Tabernacles. And they shall not appear before the Lord empty-handed. Every man shall give as he is able, according to the blessing of the Lord your God, which he has given you. This is Bible. I didn't make it up. I'm not asking for your money. God is, right? Jesus is. But that's what he's talking about there. So if you so choose, this would be the time for your tabernacles offering. We do it too, okay? We don't give, it says to give according to how you're able. If $5 is what you can give, fine. If you make $1 million a year, $5 is nothing to you, okay? So your sacrifice would look different, right? Amen. So then, the eighth day, we will celebrate on October 7th, which is Saturday at 11 a.m., our normal service time. So with all of that mentioned, I have on here Zechariah 14, 16, and it shall come to pass that everyone who is left of all the nations which came against Jerusalem shall go up from year to year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. Zechariah 14, 16. Okay, next one, 1 Corinthians 5 and 8. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. 1 Corinthians 5 and 8. Acts 18 and 21, but took leave of them, saying, I must by all means keep this coming feast in Jerusalem. This is New Testament, y'all. But took leave of them, saying, I must by all means keep this coming feast in Jerusalem, but I will return again to you, God willing. And he sailed from Ephesus. So with that, the information is out there. Please make it a point to be here. There's only one additional service at this point. If you have any questions, let us know. And if y'all will please welcome Pastor King.
Well, praise the Lord. Amen. Good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. I look out over this congregation, and I notice we have some regulars who are not here today. I know the Dear Westers can't come every week. That's just their life right now. They're not able to be here every week, but we're thankful for what they offer and how they serve. I know Young can't come every week because of his work schedule, and he lives an hour away. But he's here faithfully, and he gives into the church as well. So, you know, thank God for people like that. I see Carol. She's not feeling well today. Amy and Ben are at a family reunion. And somebody make contact with Des Galbraith and her brood of many children. Many children, yes. We get busy, a lot of things going on, but we notice certain faces aren't here for an extended period of time or a few weeks. We start to wonder. We need to be connected more than just coming to a gathering at a building in the name of the Lord outside of here. Check up on each other. Help one another out. Be a friend. Go to lunch. Go to dinner. Have somebody over for some barbecue. No grill out. We're from Indiana. We grill out all year round. It doesn't matter if there's 9 inches of snow in the driveway. I will pull that grill out, and I will put some dead animals on there, and we'll have a feast. Whatever I feel like cooking. Chicken, steak, deer. Doesn't matter. Have somebody over. Make contact with one another. Everyone is facing something right now. And I do believe that the scripture is true, that we should not forsake the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is. And even more so, the writer says, as you see the day approaching. Now, nearly 2,000 years ago, they were looking for a day that was approaching. And it was a world that was a lot different than what we're living in today. Christianity wasn't popular. Now it's becoming unpopular to those who follow the spirit of Antichrist. But it was illegal in many areas. They were persecuted, drug into arenas, fed to lions, burned at the stake, whole houses ravaged because of them following the way. Now, you think you have to pay a price to pay for that gas to come to church. Imagine if it was for your life. But the writer of the book of Hebrews says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. That just doesn't mean at 11 a.m. on Saturday morning at the Ark where we come together for an event. We are to be one as Jesus prayed for us to be one. As He told His disciples, I've taught you to be one. As He and His Father were one. And be one not just here, but outside of here. Hey, somebody says I'm important. They're messaging me. Let me turn this down. So, if you see someone here, if you see someone here and they're not here, you know, you got your friend that you sit by, or they've been in a few months, reach out to them. Reach out to them and make contact with them, because there are a lot of things pulling for our attention in this world. There are a lot of mandates. Remember a few years back, we had that word mandate floating around. Well, do you think they're going to be done with that tactic? Forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, as the manner of some is. Even more so as you see the day approaching. There may be, and I believe there is coming, a time when we have to say, you know what? Just like Peter and John, I would rather obey God than man. Pastor Tucker spoke of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They were young boys. Read the scriptures. They weren't 40-year-old adults. They were probably no more than 17 or 18. Gifted. Maybe 20. Thrown in a fiery furnace. And I remember the words they said like this to this powerful king who was fiercely angry. God had given this kingdom dominion in the earth at that time for His purpose. And they said, King, we're not afraid to answer you in this matter. We're going to obey God rather than man. Amen in Jesus' name. Well, we certainly want to welcome everyone here today, all the visitors, and we will get to the food. But you need the Word of the Lord. You need to eat this Word every day. If you feel like you've gone a day without listening to Scripture or reading Scripture, you know, that's important. You need to get back into it. I feel it. I feel it when I don't have enough Scripture in my life. I feel it. My mind feels it. How's your mind feel it? I know. My spirit, my soul,
There's something in me that desires this word. I need it. It is bread to the hungry soul. And there's something in you that should desire the Spirit of God. It is water to the thirsty. Amen. All right, please bring up the class dismissal schedule, please, and we'll get to that. Nursery 1 to 2 year olds. Beth, welcome back. Have I ever told you you're awesome? Your faithfulness back there is very evident. Thank you so much. Then we have the children's class 3 to 7. Anna and the boys are back today. They look to be feeling much better. 8 to 11 year olds, and then the youth that are here. Remember, the SAM class is not today. Due to the teacher helping out on the grill. And we'll get into the word of the Lord. Minister Gwen, it is so good to see you back again. I think you said you went to Alabama, which is one of my favorite places in the whole world. I'm glad you made it back. It's good to see you. It's very good to see you. How many of you love Jesus? I love Jesus, and I want to love Him more and more as my life progresses. Ultimately, that's the purpose of a man and a woman, is to have the love of God produced out of them to such a state of perfection that it transforms you. We're looking for a transformation. We're getting ready to enter into a trumpet's season. The trumpet is going to sound. Jesus is coming back. Though it's been said for a long time, doesn't make it any change. Jesus is coming back. It hasn't happened as of yet. Jesus is coming back. But if you notice, the kingdom is becoming more expressive. Their manifestations are becoming more expressive. You've got people that come out of nowhere that are doing a work in the kingdom right now. And where did they come from? It's that time. It is high time. We have to know the times and the seasons we are in. It's interesting that September is the month in our Gregorian calendar. That's the ninth month on the Gregorian in the Gregorian year. In the Hebrew calendar, September, in the middle of September this year, begins the seventh Hebrew month. We understand in the Hebrew calendar, the seventh month begins the start of the fall festivals. And so in our calendar, we say, well, this is September. This is the ninth month. But the very name September doesn't mean nine. The word septa means seven. Septa means seven. November means nine. You see, we've changed things. We haven't, but the powers that be that have had rulership in the earth changed calendars. But this is still and always has been, and the name even denotes it, the seventh month. And so we're looking forward to the seventh month when the trumpet will blow and the seventh day begins. You understand, when that trumpet blows, things are no longer ever going to be the same again. When the trumpet blows, I know this is not my message. You won't have to worry about inflation. When the trumpet blows, you won't have to worry about disease. When the trumpet blows, you won't have to worry about abandonment. Who didn't love you? Who didn't accept you? What job you didn't get? None of that will matter anymore. None of it.
When the trumpet blows, everything changes. God signifies what is going to happen with a voice. Listen to what is being spoken around the world today. I encourage you to pay attention. Pay attention to what the men and women of God are saying. Now, it's true that not everyone has that speaks has a word from the Lord. A lot of people speak from their soul. They speak from things they've heard. But there are men and women and who are sounding a clarion call in the earth today saying something's fitting to change. I know that governments and kingdoms and empires have fallen and risen over the last 6,000 years in this age of man. But there's a kingdom that is going to come that has been rising. Daniel said, I saw a stone cut out of a mountain. Then that became a mountain that filled the whole earth. And it smote the image of the kingdoms of this world, signified by Nebuchadnezzar's statue, at its feet. And the kingdom that we are dealing with today that's not of God is the one that got smitten first. It made everything else stand. You know, the spirit of Antichrist is nothing new. It has been anti-God as long as there's been a being that was anti-God. It's just the truth. Spirit of Antichrist has been in the world working longer than you or I have been alive. Long before my ancestors ever said their last name was King. Antichrist has been working. It worked in Nimrod, at Babel. It worked in Cain when he went and built a city. Cain that killed Abel. And it worked in that guy we call Lucifer as well. This anti-God, anti-Christ, because Jesus was and is the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So before there was ever a problem, there was a solution. And before there was a problem and God made a solution, He created all things through Jesus Christ. I'll wrap your mind around that. So we're looking forward to a seventh day meeting with the Lord, and everything will change. So get excited, get ready for that. And I promise you, your study of the Gospels, your study of the Bible, your relationship with God, your understanding will change. When you understand God through these festivals that we celebrate, your view of this whole, what we are doing, who we are, will change. You'll realize the whole duty and purpose of man from the beginning and why God does what He does. These festivals reveal why God does what He chooses to do. Why'd He say it this way? All right, let's get into the Word of the Lord. I have shared so much. I need to get into the Word of the Lord. Then we start rambling and, you know, we don't want to be out of the will of God. It's 12:14. Give me just a little bit and I'll get you out of here and get you some food. But I want to speak to the people today on the subject, the same subject I spoke last night, walking in love, which is the highest mark of a believer. Walking in love, the highest mark of a believer. So bring up 1 John chapter 3. We're going to look at verses 1 through 4. Perhaps I will add more to this today, get in a little deeper. But you have to understand the whole crux of the matter is that God is love. If you want to know what love is, if you want to hear my interpretation of what love is, hopefully it's what God says love is, go back to my series on This Is Love series. It's exactly what it's called. That's the title. The series went like 4 weeks. This is Love. And you'll see what I believe. I encourage you to look at the scriptures. But we're going to talk about today walking in love, which is the highest mark a believer can achieve or attain to. 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. Behold. You ever just look and overlook that word, behold, when you see it in the scriptures? You see it repeated throughout the scriptures. But behold is there for a reason. You want to see something. And so the writer in this passage is saying, look at this. I want you to see this. That's what I'm saying to you today. I want you to see this. And I don't see charity today. We're talking about love. I don't see charity. See all our last week. Behold what love, what manner of love. Love has a manner. You ever heard the mind your manners? Love has a manner, and there's a manner that's not love as well. Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knows us not. One of the identifying factors of being a son or a daughter of God, the world's not going to understand you. Because it knew Him not. Therefore, the world knows us not because it knew Him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when He shall appear, we shall be like Him. We're talking about the seventh day, the trumpet sounding, when He shall appear. We are looking for an appearing. But in that time period of waiting, the world's not going to understand you. They didn't understand Jesus. And why? It's because of the love that He has bestowed upon you. And every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. Whosoever commits sin transgresses also the law. For those who say that the law of God is dead and that we don't have to abide by it anymore, no, there's a law. It's the royal law. Sin is the transgression of it. Jesus took the penalty because you broke it and gave you access into His love. Whosoever commits sin transgresses the law, for sin is the transgression of the law, and you know that He was manifested to take away our sins, and in Him is no sin. I know I went over past verse 4. Whosoever sins has not seen Him, neither known Him. All right, we're going to stop right there. Father, Jehovah, we invite You. You're already here. But Father, I don't just want this to be a speech that's compelling or that maybe exhibits talent that I think I have, because I have nothing without You. I am nothing without You. My tongue is Yours. My mind is Yours. These are Your people. Father, this is Your harvest, a part of Your harvest. And so we ask that Your Word would plant seeds in their fields. Grow up in them till they come into the full measure of the stature of the fullness of Jesus Christ. Grow up in Me. And that we may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the length, the breadth, the depth, and the height, and to know the love of Christ. And that our love would abound more and more. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, Your will be done, Your kingdom come, in this earth as it is in heaven. Amen. You can be seated. Walking in love, the highest mark of a believer. I want to share with the people of the Lord today the lyrics to a song that has been on my mind. And I listened to it today, actually, in my office. Many of you know this song, and some of you don't, but it was written by a man who, interestingly, he was in ministry, and he had done some pastorships around the area. His name is Frederick M. Lehman. He wrote this in 1917. And did you know that he pastored at one point of his life in New London, Indiana? You know where New London's at? Y'all know where Rushville's at? You know where Rushville's at? If you take the country road, it's a good scenic drive a few miles to the north of Rushville. You say, what country road? It's got a name. Well, you just got to find it. It's there. You run into New London. And according to history, this man pastored, this is the only New London, Indiana that I know of, in that area. So not too far from here, actually. It's in Howard County, near the Carroll County line. But, and Howard's just, Kokomo's 20 miles, and Howard County is Kokomo, part of Kokomo there. Kokomo's part of Howard County. But the song is called The Love of God. Now, all the lyrics to the song he did not write. In fact, the third verse was actually taken from a poem that was found, and this is what I find in researching this song, was found from a person who was in an insane asylum, locked up, and they had died, and they had scribbled this poem they wrote on the wall in their state of being. Imagine writing some words that would become so well known throughout Christendom in an insane asylum. And then I further studied, and I found that the words that the person who had died in the insane asylum had written on the wall were taken from a poem that was written 1,000 years before by a Jewish rabbi. And it was inspired. So this man, Frederick Lehman, writes this song. And he is, at this point in his life, he's been in ministry. I believe he went to Nazarene College. He had graduated college. And he had been pastoring in different areas. One point was in New London. And now, all of a sudden, in his life, he's no longer in ministry. I don't know what happened to him. There's different accounts of his story. But he's out in California picking fruit, working in an orchard, picking fruit. Now, I've got family, and if you listen to their stories, they'll tell you that picking fruit didn't pay a whole lot of money. In 1917, I don't know what picking fruit paid, but if you were a picker, you weren't a rich man. You know, the rich one was the person who owned the orchard. But if you were picking, you were just getting by and making your life's paycheck, what you did to survive by picking. But now he is no longer, that I read in ministry, he's picking fruit in California, and he goes to a meeting. Aren't you thankful for those old tent meetings? He hears a minister preaching about the love of God, and he goes home. He cannot sleep. This is a rough time in his life. Apparently, he had made some business decisions that had fallen through, and now he's not in ministry. His business has fallen through, and he's just a fruit picker. He writes the words to this song, The Love of God, after a reading, after going to this meeting and hearing this preacher share this word from the insane asylum and even further back from the Jewish rabbi. The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The wandering child is reconciled by God's beloved Son, the aching soul again made whole, and priceless pardon 1. Now this is a long song. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. And if you study this, there's a lot of scripture contained and references to scripture, and you can definitely tell it's inspired by scripture. When ancient times shall pass away and human thrones and kingdoms fall, when those who hear refuse to pray on rocks and hills and mountains call, God's love so sure shall still endure, all measureless and strong. Grace will resound the whole earth round, the saints and angels' song. And the last verse, which is such, it just sums up the song so well. You're going to ask, why did I share this today? Could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and everyone a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. Written in 1917. It's amazing what comes out of a struggle. It's amazing what is produced when you've lost everything and you're relegated to picking fruit in someone else's orchard. And many of you feel like this today. You feel like maybe the price that you thought you paid in life isn't adding up. You're not seeing the fruit, and you're picking in someone else's orchard. But I want to rest assure the people of God today, the field belongs to the Lord. And we are laborers in His vineyard. And the person who starts picking at the 11th hour is going to receive the same reward as the person who started picking at daylight. The love of God, so rich and pure. I think this was the difference that the world didn't understand about Jesus. The thing that Jesus tried in His moments of privacy with the disciples to convey to them. In fact, one of the last things He said to Peter before He was resurrected, and you know, the disciples would go on and they would experience the baptism, the living Christ in spirit form coming into them at the day of Pentecost. He asked Peter three times, He said, "Peter, do you love me?" "Of course, God, I love you." "Peter, do you really love me, Peter?" "Go feed my lambs. Go feed my sheep, Peter." "You love me, Peter?" "Yes, Lord, you know I love you. Peter, I need you to feed my sheep." It's that important. One of the last principles that He taught when He walked on this earth was He was reminding one of the most important men that history would ever come into contact with. "Charity, good to see you. Charity suffers long and is kind, but there's a blessing in your suffering." Amen. I know that matters. Amen. Was to remind Peter that if you love me, I want you to feed my sheep. This is not a new concept. God is love. In fact, the scriptures were written, inspired by the very mind of God, by the men of God, and the man John, who witnessed all of these things, who writes the letter that has our text in it, says that God is love. Understand that. And in this love of God, He bestowed it upon those who would become His sons. And I say daughters because I don't like to leave the women out. But beloved, now are we the sons of God. In fact, and I love men, I love women. You know, I love you as the people of God, but when you get a new body, it's not going to matter whether you're what you were as a human. When God gives you a new body, He unites your spirit with His, your body, your soul together, and you're that, we make up the one new man. It does not yet appear what we shall be, but when we see Him, we'll be like Him. All the things we worry about on this earth will not matter. So this love that the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God, that means we were produced from God Himself. We are God's offspring. No, children act like, most of the time they look like, and live like their parents. And that tells me that we're going to look like, act like, speak like, and live like our Father God because of the love that He has bestowed upon us that we could become the sons of God. This is the very anointing Jesus walked in. The greatest anointing is not the anointing to preach a powerful message, because the message is powerful. It's not the anointing to heal the sick. It's not the anointing to raise the dead, though the dead are raised in Christ. It's not anything like that. It is the love of God being produced in you and coming out of you. Do you understand what the change is going to be? It's the thing that the Father bestowed in you that was in Jesus that changed His garments to sparkling white before He was resurrected. What does the Scripture say? The love that the Father has bestowed upon us. And when your complete, entire being becomes inundated with the same love to the point where its max capacity is overflowing, it's going to come out of you and surround you and change you. And then you'll see love like you've never seen before. Glory like you have never seen before. Peace like you've never experienced before. Joy like you've never experienced before. Light as bright as you've never seen it yet. And all of this because of what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us. That we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, you ever noticed in Scripture, I pointed out the word behold earlier. Behold, look at this. Look what I'm trying to show you, my children. Look what I'm trying to show you, people of God. Therefore, one person said it like this. It's there, so you got to know what it's there for. It's there for a reason. You need to look at that too and pay attention. The world doesn't know you because it knew Him not. The world was a completely different animal. In fact, if you read the revelation of Jesus Christ, the whole world, the system of the world, the kingdoms of the world are represented by a beast. And the beast has many heads. And the beast destroys, and the beast takes power, and the beast subjugates, and it enslaves men and women. And that's what they're trying to do today. They're trying to enslave the whole world. So not only is the whole world without Christ a slave to sin, the whole world's going to be a slave to the beast, which is a picture of the father of sin. You want to know how the devil rules his kingdom? Look at the beast. You want to know how the Lamb rules this kingdom? Look at Jesus. And so, it's a completely different way of thinking. That's why the world didn't understand Jesus. The religious didn't understand Jesus. Now, I have no issue with a person trying to have some structure and doing things in the name of God as long as they're of God and they don't violate His word. That's what religion is. In fact, the Bible gives us the definition of religion. It says pure religion is this, undefiled before God, to visit the widows and help the sick. I can't remember all of it at this moment in time. That's what you're doing in the name of God. But notice in that passage in James, none of it is selfish. That's why you hear people saying, well, all the preacher wants is money. That's all they've ever experienced is religion. All they ever want to do is tell people what to do. All they ever want to do is take and make people obey them and get followers and make people their slaves. They've only experienced religion. Pure religion and undefiled before God, sacrificial, and it's selfless. The life of Jesus was sacrificial and is sacrificial and selfless. Exhibited by the fact that God is love, Jesus being God in the flesh, and God bestowing the same love in Jesus that He's bestowed in you, first in Jesus, now in you. And so the world didn't know Him because of it, because He was opposite of their system, opposite of their father. Do you know the world has a father? Did you know that you're a child of God or you're a child of the devil? John chapter 8, Jesus is having a conversation with the Pharisees, and they're rejecting His word. I want you to understand something. The word of the Lord will always have religious antagonists. Well, we didn't see it this way. We didn't do it this way. Which is why they rail against religion. Religion tried to lock the word of God up and keep the people from eating the bread of life. You'll starve and die without the bread of life. Jesus is having this conversation with the Pharisees. They're rejecting the word, and they're claiming that they're children of Abraham. Now, we understand Abraham was the father of faith. He's the father of the faithful. He's the one God said, you go, and I'll bring you to where I need you to go. You just obey me. And Abraham believed God. Romans says he was imputed unto him for righteousness. He believed that what was not yet appearing would appear and that God would take care of him. And they say they're the children of Abraham. They're rejecting the one that Abraham looked for. And Jesus spoke in John chapter 8. He said, Abraham looked for my day, and he was glad when he saw it. But you're coming against me because I heal the sick, because I raise the dead, because I do. And you say, how can you do these things? And you're not a part of us. That's what religion does. It categorizes people. It's the us versus them. The same spirit that fuels religious fanatics is the same spirit fueling the leftists that are trying to destroy our country. The same spirit that fuels religious fanaticism is the same spirit that fuels communism, socialism, fascism, Islamic terrorism. All the isms. Fake capitalism. Categorizing people, dividing people, and eating the spoils. Taking the inheritance given to the children from the Father. That's what a religious mind will do. It will rob you of accessing your inheritance. will categorize you based on where you came from, what your pedigree is, whether or not you've got a few letters behind your name. Oh, you're not qualified to preach. You haven't been to 45 years of Bible school. Well, that's the truth anyhow. And they said, Jesus spoke it like this. He was bold with them. He said, if you were of Abraham, you do the works of Abraham. But because you're not, remember I said that there's children of God and children of the devil? Well, aren't we all God's children? Well, you're either sheep or you're a goat. How can I say that someone who God created, they belong to Him, but they're separated from Him, they don't commune with Him, they don't have the same spirit, they don't have the same blood, they don't even acknowledge Him, how can I say that God is their Father when they're living like a bastard? Just the truth. Doesn't mean God doesn't love them. It just means they're not a child of God yet. John chapter 3 and 10. So he says, John chapter 8, and then I'll jump over to 1 John 3 and 10. Same John, same writer. Jesus said, if you were of Abraham, you'd do the works of Abraham. He looked for my day. He was glad, but you do the works of your father. Your father was a murderer from the beginning. Who do you think he's talking about? And he's talking to religious fanatics who supposedly thought they had the way of life down. You're of your father, the devil. What if God said that to you? I mean, Jesus called Peter a devil. Peter was going against the written and the spoken and the divine will of God and saying he was preaching something different to Jesus. And sometimes you got to preach back at those that are antagonizing the voice of God in your life. Jesus began to talk about he has to go away, he has to be crucified, and he's going to be taken. And Peter says, no, 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 it's not going to happen. And Jesus called him a devil. Now this is Peter, pre-Holy Spirit filled. But it was still Peter who walked with Jesus, who was given the keys to the kingdom of heaven that had not yet been used. And he calls him a devil. Because Peter was preaching a different message in the ears of Jesus than Jesus was hearing from his Father. In fact, Peter was speaking like an antichrist. No, you could have the kingdom. You could have all the miracles. You could have all the power. You could have the great crowds following you without going to the cross. You don't have to do that, Lord. We can just continue on. Things will continue on as they have been. And you'll be the Messiah. And I'll have the keys. And I'll be your number one general. And we'll just go shedding Roman blood. That's really what he was thinking. And you will restore the kingdom back to Israel. David's throne will be established and it'll be grand. But you don't have to go away to do that. And he said, get behind me, Satan. You don't savor the things that be of God. It reminds me in John chapter, I believe it's 3 or 4, Jesus is led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And the devil says, hey, you bow down to me, I'll give you all of these kingdoms without a sacrifice. You see the same voice in both passages. Some of us couldn't handle it if Jesus called us a devil. But he called the Pharisees and those religious
that rejected him, children of the devil, because they started doing things. When their kingdom began to shake, Jesus comes along shaking things up. They didn't understand it. They didn't want to understand it. It didn't happen their way, and now they're plotting his death. The same spirit, and I will repeat this, that drives Islamofascism, communism, socialism, crony capitalism, is the same spirit that drives a religious fanatic. It savors not the things that be of God. It doesn't know God. It doesn't know God in His nature, and so it doesn't reflect Him. It's not produced from God. It's produced from another father, another seed, and if you're a part of it, you need to come out of it. Now, I have no problem. Now, I want to make this clear. I'm a patriot. I'm a patriot, but my first love and my first loyalty is to the Lord Jesus Christ and the influence and the furtherance and the manifestation of His kingdom. And if anything gets in the way of that, it's got to go. And we are producing after our Father. Jesus produced after His Father. You, because of the love of God in you, will produce from the love of God, or you should. That is the highest mark we can attain to. No, love isn't just some fairy tale thing you see in a movie. I know this is nothing new for y'all who've been around here. Love isn't just a fairy tale feeling that you see in a movie. Love is the essence and the manifestation of God. So when God puts a spirit in you, He's putting a seed of love in you. He's putting His very nature in you. The nature of God, the highest nature man can attain to, is God's nature, and it's manifested in God's love. That's why we're to walk in it. It doesn't matter if I preach to millions in a tent. It doesn't matter if I heal millions of sick. It doesn't matter if I open a million blinded eyes because of God. It's all because of God anyhow. If I don't love people, if I don't love you, if I don't love God first, if I don't put Him first, if I don't have a sacrificial life, it's nothing but noise. The wise old apostle in 1 Corinthians 13, I could speak in tongues and not have love, and I'm just clanging a cymbal. Now we're going to use an example here. I'm going to show you. This is what it sounds like to the Lord and things, beings in the Spirit. You want to know what the angels hear? They hear what God hears. If you are in church talking in tongues, but your tongue is a snake's, here's what it sounds like when you speak in tongues. Can you make sense of that? That's the words of the Apostle Paul. I'm a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. It sounds great. But what do they hear in the spirit? They hear my nasty tongue being hidden by an emotional experience I'm having. And I will just say that if your tongue isn't changed when the Holy Ghost comes in you, you need to have more than just an emotional experience. There needs to be some repentance. When I received the baptism of the Spirit, and I can only testify of myself, when I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, something changed in my life. My mind changed. Yeah, I still did things wrong. Yeah, I messed up. Yeah, I went into things I shouldn't have gone to, but I knew it was wrong. I knew there was a different way of living, and when I wasn't in contact with Him, I felt it. And when I didn't have that close communication and the connection with God, I felt it. Something changed in me.
Something will change in you. When the Holy Ghost gets in you, it will completely change you. It will baptize you in the love of God. It not only gives you power, it gives you the power to love and the power of love. That's real love. Bring up the book of Jude. We're going to the 21st verse. One chapter in the book of Jude. Now, some of y'all, you'd have been caught staring with your mouths open if I would have said Jude, the 35th chapter. Jude only has one letter, one chapter. Keeping yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. Now jump up before that to the verse prior, verse 20. But beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith. We like that. That's awesome. Praying in the Holy Ghost. That's even better. How many of you like to pray in the Holy Ghost? You need to learn to pray in the Holy Ghost. Let God do it through you. Whatever it takes, whatever it costs, when you pray, you let God pray through you in the Holy Ghost. Let Him come inside of you. I promise you it'll change you. But the next verse says, keeping yourselves in the love of God. So here's the problem in a lot of churches. We do a lot of sounding brass and tinkling cymbal and speaking in tongues, but we don't stay in the love of God, and we start getting off into other areas, and then we start causing problems in the kingdom rather than building it up. And we start causing issues in our lives because the heart is where the issues come out of, right? Guard it. How do you guard it? You got to let something greater than you guard it. You gotta let God put a guard on your heart. Can't come across this line. I got the blood of Jesus and the Spirit of the Lord. And the word of my testimony says you can't come here. So you gotta guard your heart. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Build yourself up on your most holy faith. But while you're doing that, Here's what's going to keep all of that in order. Keeping yourselves in the love of God. Realizing that the whole gospel is about the love of God. Realizing that the whole plan of redemption is about the love of God. Realizing that God is love. And if you're going to be in God and you're going to be produced out of God, you're going to be in love too. You're going to walk in it. So if it's possible, according to the scriptures and what is translated here, to keep myself in the love of God, it's possible to not keep myself in the love of God. Which is where a lot of Christians are. They learn everything else. They learn the do's, the don'ts. They learn the you can't go here. They learn you can't go there. They learn to speak in tongues. They learn to lay hands on the sick. They learn to get together and hold hands and worship God. But they don't keep themselves in the love of God, which is the crux of the whole matter. Which is the foundation. And so they have issues that are hidden oftentimes and attitudes that are unchecked and will say the most vile things to the people they're supposed to love. The greatest achievement as a man that I could ever, as a man of God, that I could ever achieve is to be perfected in the love of God. If there's anything that I know that I can pass down, that my children will be able to eat from and live from, and that my wife will be able to live from, it's the love of God manifested in me from Jesus Christ and the Father. There's a difference between God's ways and God's works. Now, God's ways produce His works. But those who see His works don't always understand His ways. It's the crowds following Jesus, the multitudes, over 5,000 twice. Eating loaves, eating fishes, experiencing the effects of God's works. Eating from the hand that was the tree of life, giving bread and fish, and then to His disciples, and to them they would distribute, and the bread and fish would grow. They loved the works. They loved the ruler of the synagogue's daughter being raised from the dead. They loved the Lazarus come forth. They loved the man being lowered down through the hole in the roof of the house. And I love those things too. I love the God of those things more than I love those things. But when the pressure became more than they could handle, many of them went away, and Jesus was left with a few, and He said, are you going to go away as well? They got the loaves, they got the fishes, they got the miracles, they showed up for the show, but they sat on the pew, and they walked out, they said a few words in tongues, and nothing changed in their life. They don't understand the heart of the matter. Keeping yourselves in the love of God. God's intention all along was to produce the same love in Him, in them. God is love. God is light. And so oftentimes those who don't understand His ways have these hidden issues. They don't understand His love. And so what they do it in a religious manner. Like they drink coffee. I like to drink coffee. I got some amazing coffee. My friend from Hawaii sent me some coffee. He lives on the Big Island. He's a pastor I met at Morningstar. He sent me some Hawaiian Kona coffee straight from the island. Praise God. I love coffee. And I kind of drink it religiously. But that's not going to save me. That's not going to keep me. It's going to make me feel good. I'm going to like the taste of it. There's going to be some health benefits. But it's not going to keep me. What's going to keep me? Not only building myself up in my most holy faith, not only praying in the Holy Ghost, I can do that, but keeping myself in the love of God. If I get outside the love of God, I have lost sight of my entire purpose. I don't preach from this pulpit without the love of God. If I do, I'm a cymbal that's clanging. I don't heal a sick person or lay hands and let God use me to minister to a sick person without the love of God. If I do it, I've lost sight of everything. And so we will produce after our Father. Your whole identity and my whole identity is because of what the Father has bestowed on us and upon us. We say we're sons of God. Let me tell you what that looks like. The love of the Father bestowed on you. And the love of the Father bestowed upon you is going to be the same love of the Father that comes out of you, the same love of the Father that comes out of you when you minister, the same love of the Father that comes out of you when you embrace your wife or your children, the same love of the Father that's going to keep you while you go through the menial tasks of daily life. When you're cooking eggs at the stove because your daughter asked for eggs at 9:30 at night. That's just my household. Whatever you do in your household, okay. I'll say no about 3 times and then I'll just relent because I love her and eggs are good anyway. Okay. She's hungry. Takes me about 5 minutes to make an egg. It's the same love that's going to keep me doing that in the right spirit at 9:30 at night, making my daughter an egg. What's it matter if I come to church and I speak in tongues and I run all over the place and I go out there and my tongue is a vile, nasty, poison-laden serpent's tongue? Well, it's good teaching anyhow. I need to hurry along. Many places in the Scripture where love is talked about, what is the central theme? And Jesus says this, I believe it's John chapter 13. And He says, a new commandment I give to you. All right, these are the 12. Maybe the women too. I'm not exactly sure who was all around at that moment, but the 12, one of the 12, John's writing it. He says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Remember, all of the law and all of the prophets hang on two things. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your mind, all of your strength. Jesus is quoting from the Torah. And then He says, the second, love your neighbor as yourself. It's a new commandment I give you. You know those other 10, but this is the 10 coming together. Loving God first and loving your neighbor. Love one another as I have loved you. Why? Because all men, they're not going to know you're my disciples because you heal the sick. They're not going to know you're my disciples because you raise the dead. They'll come for the effects and they'll walk away unchanged. They are going to know you are my disciples because of what? The love you have one to another. So simple. That's why the New Testament writers, these apostles, wrote on love so much. Peter. 1 Peter 4, verse 8. Have fervent charity among yourselves. Paul. Romans 13 and 10, love is the fulfilling of the law. Read on in that or read before that in the Scripture passage, you'll find he talks about loving his neighbor. 1 Corinthians 13 and 10, Paul, that perfect thing that's coming, the whole love chapter, that perfect part that is going to be revealed, where Paul's talking about, we see in part, we prophesy in part, we know in part, but when that which is perfect is come, that's in the love chapter. It really is the whole matter. Love is the fulfilling of the law. Loving God first. Loving your neighbor as yourself. The love the Father has bestowed upon you that you can be called the sons of God didn't come because somebody said, get up and come out of your sickness and you're healed. It didn't come when they raised you from the dead. It didn't come when they opened your blinded eyes. It came when the love of God was bestowed upon you and you received the same identity, the same mind, and the essence of God like Jesus had. Thank you. Love is his way. Love is what he bases his covenant off of. It brings light, life, and peace. If you lack peace in your life, you're not experiencing the love of God the way you should. If I know that he loves me, I know he's going to take care of me. I know that he's going to handle every situation that I may have caused myself even. But if I know that he loves me, I don't doubt that he loves me. It will allow me to stay in peace. All of what God does is birthed and through and out of his love. The writer in the book of 1 John. So if we love one another, we won't be walking in darkness. If you say you love God, but you hate your brother, you walk in darkness. Anywhere you see love, light is associated with it. Jesus was and is the love of God and all of God manifested in a human form. Jesus was and is the light of the world. But you know who else he said was the light of the world? Jesus' words, you and I. The same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. If it is in you, it will quicken your mortal body. We're looking for a resurrection. The same Spirit that was in Jesus, that became the light of the world, that shined in the darkness, is the same Spirit that is in you, that is the light of the world, that shines in the darkness. Anywhere you see love, there's always light. This covenant that I was talking about that God has made with us, that his fire is going between the pieces of that are the sacrifice that's in the covenant. It brings light, life, and peace. When you are in a love relationship, and I'm finishing up, when you're in a love relationship, there are things that you and I need in order for that relationship to be a success. I hate to say it like that, a success, but for that relationship to be a living relationship, a living, breathing covenant, that God is in the middle. There has to be intimacy. You remember, some of y'all remember this. I'm not the one who, in my old wise mind, that came up with all of these. I know they were there, but I didn't put them out into a message. I heard something preached, and then I added one. That is from me. There has to be intimacy. There has to be transparency. And what happens when a thing is transparent and light shines through it? Nothing is hidden. You'll see every dirty speck on the glass. Right? You'll see what needs cleaned up. This is good for you. Good for your spirit. Intimacy, transparency, vulnerability. That's why your covenant ain't working out very well, some of you, because you ain't vulnerable. And here's one we hate that the world absolutely goes and detests. They go against it. They say that it's patriarchal, whatever label they can put on it. Accountability. There's no accountability anymore. Well, I can do whatever I want because I'm a free man and I'm a free woman, and you can pay whatever price and hope to get yourself out of the mess that you got yourself into because you didn't want to be accountable. Now, we're not talking about abuse. We're talking about accountability. And me, myself, keeping myself in the love of God puts me in a position where I'm accountable to the light of God. Intimacy, transparency, vulnerability, accountability. Those things are required and necessary for a covenant to reach its full life capacity. To grow, to live, to thrive. It's your body lives, thrives, and grows. What you put into it. It has a system. Everything has to work right. You can live without an arm, but your quality of life is diminished. There's a purpose you have two arms, right? So if we're loving one another, we won't be walking in darkness. We love God. We love those around us. We walk in light. Light and love always come together. Darkness is always associated with fear. God has no opposite, but God has an antagonist, and it's called fear. Love is God. God is love. But there is no fear in love. If you're afraid, you're not being made perfect in love. Same writer, same 1 John, but chapter 4. So darkness and fear are always associated. Why do you think you hear the term the dark movies, the horror movies, the things that come out of the darkness? Freddy Krueger coming in your dreams when you're sleeping, mainly in the darkness, right? When you sleep in the night. That's the Apostle Paul. When you're awake, when you're drunk in the night. When you're awake, you're in the light. We're not children of the darkness, we're children of light. Dark things associated with fear. Fear has what John says is torment. So light brings in visibility to a covenant, to a relationship. Love is always with light, always comes with love. The opposite of what God's will is darkness and fear. And I wrote this down, I'll make this statement. Love is not something we conveniently push aside and use when we feel that someone or something is worthy of it. Talking about walking in love. You and I are supposed to walk in love 24 hours a day. Your whole life. In fact, every step you make in the kingdom, every season of growth you go through, should produce in you and I a new measure, a new manifestation, a new level, a new depth, a new knowledge, a new understanding of the love of God. When you finally learn to let go of yourself, and God uses you in mighty signs and wonders and miraculous deeds, there will be accompanying that, the new level of love for you to walk in and understand. You will never get away from it. God's way. God's way is from His heart. His heart is from His being and His whole mind. The mind of God controls the heart of God, which produces the ways of God and manifests in the works of God. God's way is love. Now see, here's what we do. Last point. Here's what we do. So then we get religious, and it's the same spirit. It's the same spirit that messes up marriages and family relationships and church relationships. And it causes us to antagonize one another, to be against one another. Well, they don't agree with me, so I'm just going to be, and I like to use this term, indifferent. And do you know what indifference is in a covenant relationship? Starving someone or something of love. Well, I'm indifferent. So I can't say nothing nice because my heart has a place of, the needs healed, and it's a little dark in there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to be indifferent to them, and I won't say anything at all. You are starving them of love that you didn't produce in yourself. And indifference will also cause wounds, hurts, pains, and things to happen in relationships, in family relationships, in marital relationships. You need to get the indifference out of your marital covenant, because that's the most direct covenant you have to your relationship with God. Quit being hardened in your heart and being indifferent to your spouse because they hurt you, or you hurt them, or y'all are mad at each other. Grow up, keep yourself in the love of God, and get the indifference out. Because you are actually undoing every step that you have made, everything that has been put together, every growth that you have received or growth that you have come into, you are undoing it by your indifference. You know, the Lord said, if you're hot or cold, you're good. It's not saying being cold to the things of God. It's saying some water is refreshing and some water is cleansing, right? Hot water has its value. Cold water has its value. But lukewarm water is a place where mosquitoes lay their eggs and it becomes a swamp. And mosquitoes suck the blood out of you, and I don't like mosquitoes. I don't know about you. Indifference is your lukewarmness. You're not given refreshing love, and you're not given cleansing love. You're being indifferent, so you're lukewarm, and it causes God to want to spew you out of his mouth. And indifference is no reflection of the heart or the ways of God. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us. When I messed up, yes. When I let him down, yes. When I hurt myself, yes. When I hurt others, yes. When I walked away, yes. When I spoke what I shouldn't have spoken, yes. When I denied him, yes. And God was no more indifferent to you. God was not indifferent to you or I, even when we were unable, didn't have the capacity to receive or give love. In Jesus' name. So get the indifference out of your life. Because it's just a reflection of lukewarmness. In Jesus' name. All right. Now that I made everyone mad, you can stand. Walk in love, children of God. Walk in love. Let's lift up our hands in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. God, we ask you that you will give us a new revelation, a new manifestation, a new understanding, a new walk in the love of God, that we would be able to walk it, talk it, live it, show it, breathe it every day, that we know that you were not indifferent to us. You were not withholding even when we really didn't deserve it, and you were not holding anything back when we even rejected your word. You still bestowed the love of the Father in us. We want that same love that Jesus walked in and walks in now to be in our lives. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, everyone said amen. And Lord, we ask you to bless the food. Help it to nourish our bodies. Lord, we just thank you for the blessings, and let us love one another as you've loved us, and make us one. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. God bless you. Love y'all. We'll see you next week. If you need prayer, if you need something, of course, we're here to minister. If not, enjoy the food. Thank you for joining us out there on live stream. I hope this spoke to you, and I believe it did. God bless you. Shalom.